C4 and Bryan Nehman.
WBAL News Radio 1090, FM 101.5, and the WBAL radio app.
And a good Thursday morning to you, the first day of December. Bryan Nehman, C4 here on the C4 and Bryan Nehman Show. And as always, we are pleased to have as a guest the mayor of Baltimore, Brandon Scott. Mr. Mayor,
good morning, Mr. Mayor.
Good morning, gentlemen. Good morning. I hope you both had a great Thanksgiving.
You too. Happy holidays to you.
You did as well. We've got a lot to talk about. I did want to start with the big news item of the week, and that is this pension bill that passed in the city council that would shorten the time an elected official needs to qualify for a pension from 12 years to 8. I know the ethics board has questions about it. Was that the sole reason you decided to veto it?
No. Before the ethics board even sent that letter, I knew that I was going to veto it. Listen, Bryan, as public servants, it's our duty to maintain public trust. We swear to execute our duties without partiality or prejudice. And I think a lot of people are aware of those ethical issues surrounding the bill, namely the fact that it allows current officials in office to become vested earlier than they would have under the current law, even though the passing of the charter amendment doesn't really impact them. And I couldn't in good conscience sign that bill into law. It's my job to make a decision that is in the best interest of the city and the residents, period, which is why I decided to veto the bill.
Baltimore City Mayor Brandon Scott is on board with us. And Mr. Mayor, did you have an opportunity to speak with the president of the city council, Nick Mosby, who really was the main sponsor of this? And, you know, he had seven other council members with him. You know, many, you know, you serve with a lot of them. Did you talk with any of them prior to vetoing this?
I heard from a bunch of council members. I did not, over the holiday, have a chance to speak with him directly. But we made sure that before anyone else had what we were sending out, that they had it. Because, listen, it's just the right thing to do. And as I said, C4, in that letter, that we know that would happen with the change, there needs to be a conversation about the compensation and how that works. But that should be done, as I think, through that elected officials compensation committee that you know about deeply, that we haven't had put in for a while. Because when you think about how things look like, even from the fact that folks look at the council as part time, and you and I both know you cannot be a city council person in Baltimore on a part time basis.
If you do it right.
There's no way. So we have to look at all of that, and we look forward to working with them to do that in a more elongated and, I think, proper process.
But so you're not totally against a bill that would shorten the pension process
time? I'm not saying that, Bryan. Listen, when I got elected, it was 12 years, and that's what it is for me, and that's what I think it should be for me. What I'm talking about is we have to look at the entire system to see how it should work, not just solely based off question K, but based off also the things and the realities that C4 and I were just discussing as well.
Okay, you mentioned question K. I did want to ask you about that. What do you think the message was sent from voters if 72% voted in favor of term limits?
Well, listen, Bryan, you know that long before a media mogul decided to get involved in term limits, I voted for term limits on the council twice. I think what we do know is that with voters, the folks that vote, they said that they want them, right? But also, if you go to East and West Baltimore and you ask folks about term limits, they say we already had term limits. The term limits were when we got tired of somebody, we voted them out.
Well, can I just push back on the media mogul aspect of it? And I'm not a sycophant for Fox 45 or Sinclair. I don't obviously work for them. But, I mean, if we're talking about $500,000 and that impacted a vote that had 72% of it, don't you think that would have passed no matter what? I mean, if $500,000, you get 72% of people to vote for, what else could do it?
I think you're underestimating a portion of it. It's not just the $500,000. I think what I would encourage you to do is go and read the column from Dan Rodericks about it's not just the $500,000. It's also about, you know, the fact that basically it's free airtime consistently over and over. Only then. The folks at Hearst would never do that. And I think that's a totally separate conversation for a totally separate day that you and I can.
Okay,
I think we actually should have.
That's fair, but did it impact? I mean, was it a difference maker in it passing of 72%? I mean, that's overwhelming. You can't get a lot of people to agree on much in the city, but 72% is a huge number.
Bryan,
right?
Things don't get on the ballot without support behind them. That's what I think you have to understand. It's getting it voted on is easy. Once it gets on the ballot, C4, what's the last thing that got on the ballot that didn't pass in Baltimore?
Very few things. But you must admit 72% is an overwhelming number, Mr. Mayor.
Oh, no, you get no disagreement from me. But
okay.
Listen,
but you're right about the passage
part. I had something on the ballot that passed with 80%. Mm-hmm. So listen, I understand what you're talking about, Brian. But I think that we can't just poo-poo that because we know that there's a lot more there. But like I said before, I support term limits, so it is what it is. Mm-hmm.
Let me ask you, Mr. Mayor, when it comes to the veto of this, have you talked, there were 8 votes there originally for it. Have you talked with members of the council? Do you think they can get 10 votes to override you?
I do not. I don't think so, and I hope not. And we're just going to be working and talking to the council members about making sure that we do this kind of process in a proper elongated way with a separate commission that we know that we can call, that I said we want to call in the veto letter, so that this discussion can be had in any better way.
I wanted to ask you about the Squeegee Collaborative. We haven't had you on since the recommendations came out. What is your confidence level that this is going to work, that this is going to be the thing that actually turns the corner on the squeegee problem that we have?
I think, Brian, what you heard, not just from me, what you heard, if you guys were down the night that we had the Baltimore Peninsula rebranding, what you heard from Kevin Plank, what you heard from Shalonda Stokes, what you heard from folks across the business community, city, folks from Squeegee, people who are involved in philanthropic efforts, that this is the first time in at least the 40-something years that this issue has existed in Baltimore, that we actually got down to coming up with an action plan for every single solitary thing. I'm very confident that because of that collaboration, because of that consensus, because of that will for all of those parties to be involved and making sure that this works the right way, yes, there are going to be hiccups. We all know that. You guys have hiccups on the show. Some drop that's supposed to drop doesn't drop, but you have to adjust from that and keep improving and move on. I'm very confident because for the first time, we have everybody at the table and that we're going to push that way.
Baltimore City Mayor Brandon Scott is on board with us. And Mr. Mayor, there have been those concerned about why are we doing this January 10th and not after your meeting that occurred December the 10th to try to establish the pattern of what you've described with the Squeegee Collaborative. And the reason I'm asking that is not long after your announcement on the 10th, when you made the Squeegee Collaborative announcement, a 19-year-old Squeegee worker was arrested with a loaded weapon on the streets. And the concern is there are more young people out here with loaded weapons on these streets, and we could have another Timothy Reynolds again.
Well, I think C4, what I will say to that is that you know me, and you know me well enough. I don't care if they're out there squeegeeing. I don't care if they're radio tech at WBL Radio. I don't care if they're driving Amazon. If they have an illegal gun, we are going to try to remove them off the streets of Baltimore. And I think the evidence is already there. It doesn't matter where they are in the city to me. It doesn't matter if they're 19, 14, 15, 30, 40, 50, 60 years old, because we've made gun arrests of people in every single age range. When you think about the reality is, as through of yesterday, we had seized 2,300 guns, made 1,495 gun arrests, more than we made, 18% more than last year, seizing 13% more guns than last year. We are going after those individuals with the guns and arresting them. But you know where I'm about to go. The most important thing that needs to be discussed continuously, and I know you two do a great job of doing that, some other media folks not so much, what happens after that? Why is it that the police department consistently, when folks are doing these carjackings and all of these things, it's the same folks over and over and over again? And when you're talking about us waiting, it's about making sure that we put all the policy and program and operational stuff in place, that we have all of our partners ready because they have to build up. And then you also know that we're going to be going through changes in government leadership as well. All of that plays the factor in why we have to do that. But we will continue to, as we always have and always will, hold people accountable, whether they're walking down the street.
But the reason I'm asking that, Mr. Mayor, right now the city is facing a potential, they've already announced a civil suit at the corner of what happened at Conway and Light. And the more that these young people are out here, considering everything that's going on, doesn't that open the city up from a liability standpoint if you don't stop the activity as soon as possible?
Well, what I will say, one thing, you know, I can't talk about open litigation before, but what I will say is, to me, it doesn't matter where it happens and who has the gun and what reason. It's about holding that person accountable, and that's what we're always going to do.
Mr. Mayor, my biggest concern about it on the collaborative plan is that you're going to have these six intersections where you say no squeegeeing allowed, right? So you're going to have squeegee-free zones. And we all know that in free market societies, if you have places where you can't do it, it will just move to a different area. What do you really think is going to stop someone who is at the corner, who was at the corner of Light and Conway, from just moving literally 200 yards down the road to Light and Pratt?
Well, you got, it's not just Light and Conway. It's the whole region, Bryan. If you think about, look through the plan. But more importantly, we know, right? We know, just like with regular policing, there's always going to be movement. And we, as we said that day, and we'll continue to say, we will make adjustments. But it's not just about that. It's about taking it away from these places where we know the money is there, but the accountability, remember, it's not just on the workers, it's also on the drivers. And when you bring those resources and expand those resources in the way that we'll be able to do, now that we have all these other partners involved, we think that we can have a very, very deep impact on that.
So, but you don't think you'll be playing whack-a-mole, just moving around to different parts of the city?
Bryan,
why not?
We want to remove them from it, period. But if you, I'll use an analogy that I know your co-host understands, right? C4 grew up in West Baltimore. If you're on Fulton and North Avenue and you have a drug corner and the police shut that corner down and you have to move to Lafayette in some obscure street, you're not going to make the same amount of money. And that's what we're talking about here. We're talking about economy here as well. And that's why we also know it's about all of the things. Not one thing, as you heard from me consistently, Bryan, not one thing is going to solve this problem. If that were the case, 40 years ago, they would have solved the problem with the ideas that people keep saying over and over and over and over and over again. That didn't happen. We have to do all of the things, and that's why we believe we're going to have an impact this time.
Mayor Brandon Scott, when it comes to the most recent incidences of ride-sharing folks, whether it's Uber, yep, Lyft, whatever, being robbed, the actual drivers being having their cars taken away and then robbing individuals they pick up, we've been talking about the fact, we know there's been some arrests made. Shouldn't we be a little more public with letting the public know that these entities are safe and maybe announcing who's been arrested? I mean, make people confident through this Christmas season that they can use ride-sharing.
Yeah, I think a couple of things about that. One, you're right, and that's why we've had the police department talking to you guys, talking to WBL, other media partners. But you also know, C4, about some of the restrictions on saying who's been arrested, et cetera, et cetera. And this goes back to the earlier conversation. This is something that I was speaking with the deputy commissioner about throughout the weekend and making sure that they were on it and talking to those rideshare apps as well, because we have to make sure that they're trying to put anything that they can put in place. But more importantly, it goes back to the same conversation we were just having, C4. These individuals all the time are the same ones. We go out, we break a carjacking ring, we break a robbery ring, we make this arrest, and then a few months later, we see the same individuals. I'll just, without giving you the details, I'll just tell you this one incident. Last November, around this time, we arrested someone for a robbery, a carjacking robbery, actually on behalf of Baltimore County, right? That individual was arrested. In June of this year, that person pled guilty to said carjacking in Baltimore County. In August of this year, we arrested that person for other incidents here in Baltimore City. You get, like, I want people to understand
well,
this.
Why don't
point.
We call that out, Mr. Yeah, I'm not asking
well,
you.
I
I'm
do
not...
call it. Well, as you know, I call it out every month with you guys and every time I talk to the media everywhere. But unlike the two of you, we have to get more folks to start to put pressure on that other side to see what's going on, to say, like, hey, what's going on with these court commissioners? What's going on with some of the judges? Why is this thing happening? Because you can, you know, folks can ask me till I'm blue in the face.
Right.
But my job is to make sure that the police arrest
them. But I guess what I'm saying, Mr. Mayor, is when Bryan and I say it, yeah, it's one thing. But when it comes from either you or the police commissioner, who we could probably have next week, we're getting them on maybe next week, we need to know, okay, this person went to court. They were sentenced. Yeah. Instead of them being, like, poor Ms. Michelle Cumming, who was killed in Annapolis. This individual should never have been on the street to
never
kill the mother of a cadet I was saying we need people in your position to call some of this out. That's all.
I fully agree. And this is something that I personally do consistently, C4, and going to continue to do that. And always appreciate you and Bryan for understanding the totality of the system. And we need other folks to do that. But I'm just going to be honest, you know, in some cases for some folks in, on the media side, it's just easier to just say what the police and the mayor doing, right? Folks don't want to go and say like, oh, well, maybe we should look up this stuff to see what actually happened after.
Well, I would like the information at carjacking. I'll get with you. We want to talk about that. There's no reason in the world after a carjack, that person should have been on the street.
You would be amazed at how many times it happens.
Well, do you have confidence that, obviously you can't do much about the judges, but we will have a new prosecutor in place in a month's time. Do you think some of these things will be cleared up, if you will?
I think it's not just him, and I do think that Ivan, ironically, he just sent me a message while we were on air. I do think that we're going to have a lot of improvement there, right? But again, this is about the complete system. This is why you always hear me talking about the governor, right? And C4 knows that so many of those agencies actually report to the governor. I think having Governor Moore is going to be a big help for us on the public safety front. But also, just so that you know, C4, we have been talking about in our CJCC meetings about a public safety accountability dashboard. Well, we're trying to put all of that in one place so that people can actually see it, right?
Except for the judges.
Well, yeah, we'll get to that. We're gonna keep working on that. I'm feeling a little more confident that we'll get that happening.
All
maybe in the next month or two, we'll have a different response. I'll just say leave it at that on that. But I think that we're gonna try to get everybody to be a part of that. But that dashboard and having these two gentlemen come and really wanting to be a part of fixing the entire system, right? Because State's Attorney Bates knows it on both sides, being in the State's Attorney's office before and then being a private attorney. Governor Moore knows that we have to have, as you hear him consistently talk about, making sure that parole and probation is funded and given the proper tools. All of those things matter, Bryan, when you're talking about public safety, not just in Baltimore, as you just heard C4 elaborate on, but across the state of Maryland, because these things are happening across jurisdiction line, just like this Uber thing is happening in the city and the county. We had incidents down in Anne Arundel. All of us are seeing the issues that come from us not fixing systemic things that we have to fix.
Mayor Brandon Scott, finally from me, and that has to deal with the fact that we sit here today at 308 homicides, 652 non-fatal shootings. We're going to get to 700 tragically just based on the pace. So here we are, the same numbers we've seen for 7 years. Why do you think 2023 is going to be different?
Well, I think a couple of things. C4. Although it's very small, we know that right now we are, especially with non-fatal shootings, and we're seeing a small decrease, and we hope to continue that through the end of the year and end the year strong. I just be reminded when you, Bryan, and I were talking in January and February, we were talking about a 30%+ increase in both categories. But when you look at what we've been able to do, especially with GVRS over in the Western District, and know that we're going to take it now and expand it through other districts. You'll hear from me about that very, very shortly. I can't give you the details just yet. But over there, the Western, the historically most violent district that you represented, has a combined drop in homicides and shooting of 29%. Having that now grow to other districts, it's going to be helpful to continue now that we started this year out eliminating a lot of the calls and things that BPD didn't do on, with expanding our CBI work, the mediations, the things that are happening. We, with our increased federal partnerships with our great U.S. Attorney Eric Byrne, having a new governor, having a new state's attorney, folks that are ready to work in true partnership. That's why I'm very hopeful that now we'll turn the tide, because I think we'll see less of that revolving door, that my police are out there arresting the same people over and over. The folks at Safe Streets and our other CVI, We Are Us, are intervening with the same folks over and over, because we'll be able to get them the help and get them away into another way of life. All of the things is why.
Just real quick before the mayor's Christmas parade is going to happen.
Oh, absolutely. I told everyone that it must happen and it is going to happen. And what we have to make sure is that moving forward, Bryan, that folks use a little bit of common sense when working with our community partners about these kind of events and making sure that they're looking at things when the agencies are looking at things, when things like the Raven schedule comes out, to make sure that we don't have these kind of mishaps in the future. But I look forward to being there, and I'm predicting, C4, early that I'm going to be joined by the Dunbar football team as they're going to win another state championship by beating the crap out of Patuxent on Saturday.
Oh, I know they will. And as I leave you, Mr. Mayor, two numbers are in my mind, 14 and 6. Let me see.
That was the score of a certain game.
Oh, yeah. No, I told you online.
I'm just remember.
You got your crab cake coming from me. I already had to pay off a lunch that I'm going to hear about for the rest of my life.
All right.
C4, but you got it. But look, I just want to remind you of one thing.
Yes, sir.
Once every 12 years is like the blood moon.
Goodbye, Mr. Bear. Happy holidays to you.
Thank you, sir. Happy holidays. Appreciate you coming on. Thank you so much.